Hello children, today let's discuss regarding sustainable management of natural resources. Under the management of natural resources, we would cover the subtopics, that is water for all, dams, the criticism which is because of the traditions not been followed, then next regarding the water harvesting, coal and petroleum, and then the next one is environment friendly practices. Water for all. Water is basically the necessity for all terrestrial forms of life. Human intervention is changing the availability of water in various regions. Now the regions where scarcity of water is excessively noted, now that can be very directly correlated with acute poverty. So both are going hand in hand. Rains in India are largely due to monsoons. Even if excessive rainfall occurs, it is failing to meet the water demands of people living in our country. Now, if sustained water, that is underground water, usage is being checked, it would help that the water, that is the underground water. So during the British time, some of the systems have changed. Before them, it was all traditional methods which were followed by the peasants, the farmers. But now it has changed the system, that is during the British rule. Conception of large scale projects like construction of dams, canals, which were passing through larger areas, were took into action. And after them, the independent government, and it has continued with the same concept which was followed during the British rule. Now the huge projects which has led to neglecting of theocal irrigation methods, and then government has also took over the administration of the systems, and then the control of people over these local water sources has come down. As a result, what has happened? Usage of water was not been enough, and then people were suffering. In certain areas like Himachal Pradesh, at that time people used to construct certain structures for irrigation, something like kuls in Himachal Pradesh. Parts of Himachal Pradesh, they have started with a local irrigation canal system called as kuls over 400 years ago. Now the water which starts flowing through the streams was diverted into the man-made channels, and then which was supplied to a lot of villages down the hillside. The management of the water flowing in these wells was by common agreement among the villagers. The most interesting part of it was during plantation season, water was first used by the village that was farthest away from the source of kul. Then by the villages progressively higher up. These kuls were managed by 2 to 3 people. Okay, and these people were paid by the villagers so that it would be like a small job which they would carry on time to time without failing. And then according to the rule, it would be carrying forward. In addition to the system of irrigation, the water from the kuls basically used to percolate into the deep layers of the soil, and it was fed into the springs which gushes through the underground level, and then it would also help in recharging of the groundwaters. But what has happened with time, with the development, These schools were taken over by irrigation department, and most of them have become defunctional, and they were no more, you know, useful for sharing of water, or that much sharing in a equitable manner was not occurring as which was occurring before. Now, when we were talking about some of the methods followed by different states, something like just now we said the kuls of Himachal Pradesh, same ways, different states have been following different methods. From the state of Rajasthan, nadis, tanks and kadins have been made to store and save water. Maharashtra, bandiras and tals. Madhya Pradesh, bundis. Bihar, pines and pais. Himachal Pradesh, we already discussed, kuls. Jammu region, small ponds. In case of Tamil Nadu, it is eris or small tanks, or they also call them as kattas, where that would be preventing excessive flow of water and stagnation for some time, so that it is percolating down into the lower layers and then helping in recharging the ground level of water. Regarding how they have used, we also can have a look at the traditional water harvesting system, where one of the ideal setting of the garden system, where there would be the area from where they call as the catchment area. You can have a look at their catchment area from where water flows down and it has been accumulated in khadin or the cropped area, and there are certain bunds being made. So when the water is being accumulated in this area, the water easily gets percolated down. Then after that, you can see near that there would be saline area, that is the water which has been saline passing through those areas, where they are not being let to come into contact. As a result, what is happening, the fresh waters have been remaining the same, and it is also helping in recharging the shallow wells and the wells present in the. Next, let's just talk about dams which were constructed. Large dams, they basically ensure the storage of adequate water. Okay, not just for one purpose, but also that is for just for irrigation. It is also supporting for generation of electricity. Now, the canals basically, which are starting from the dams and passing into the different areas or passing through a large distances, right? What will it do? It can transfer enough amount of water. For example, Indira Gandhi Canal, that has brought a lot of greenery to major areas of Rajasthan. Okay, so what is happening over here? But only issue is equitable distribution of water. If as it is not occurring, people are moving towards the source. Okay, and they are also growing water intense crops like sugarcane, rice. Okay, and then the people which are like who are living in a farther away or an area away from it do not get water at all. This is one of the flaws or the drawbacks. Initially, what has happened, when during the construction of the dams, people were promised that water would be distributed evenly through. Right. Now, what has happened? The woes of these people who have been promised the benefits, right? Now, as they have not been filled up, okay, what is happening? Now, this has become a reason for opposition for the construction of huge dams. Now, it's like since long it's been heard about a Tehri dam built over the river Ganga. Okay. And we have also heard of some of the protests like Narmada Bachao Andolan, okay, which was raising above the height of the Sardar Sarovar Dam over river Narmada. So these farmers were protesting against such things. So that was one of few of the criticisms seen against that. Right. So what was the criticism about the large dams? Now here different problems can be seen. Social problems of the people, because large number of peasants had to clear up that area where construction of dam would occur, or it could be the tribals who were like asked to relocate, and proper recompensation, okay, compensation or their rehabilitation wasn't provided. This was a bigger problem where people were losing their home and they were not given any other source option. Then next thing over here, economic problems, because they swallow up, construction of such huge structures will swallow up a lot of money, okay, without any kind of benefits being generated. The next thing, environmental problems, because they contribute enormously to deforestation and loss of biological diversity. Now just now we discussed regarding the building of Sawa Dam over river Ganga, right? That protests against it has started from 1970s. They've been fighting for their benefits till the date. So let's discuss regarding water harvesting. Watershed management, it stresses on scientifically soil and water conservation in order to increase the biomass of those areas or biomass production. The aim to develop the primary resources of land and water and to produce the secondary resources for these same plants and animals for use were in a manner considered. Now these communities have used hundreds of water saving methods to capture every drop of water that has fallen on their lands. So what were the procedures they have met with, or they have started with or opted? They have dug small pits, okay, so that whatever water is being like full flowing gets drained into it, helping in recharging of the ground level water. Or they would make area so that they get converted in the form of small lakes, or diverting them into already existing lakes, okay, and starting with simple watershed systems. Because of these watershed systems, sharing of water becomes very easier, storage of water is being better, building small earthen dams, something like, you know, like percolation areas where water is being held up in an area because of those dams which have been constructed. Either they have been made masonry or it could be earthen, okay, mostly earthen they have been using over here. And then it also would help in percolation of water, construction of dikes. Those dikes would be a small elevation. The dikes basically are a small elevated areas where they would be to a height of 0.3 meters so that they do not let the soil and water to get washed away. Water remains within those small lands and also soil doesn't get eroded, right? So they are also being useful as, like, you know, limestone reservoirs, sand reservoirs. And they have set up rooftop water collecting units over the tops of houses. Pipelines are being arranged in such a manner rainwater is collected and they would get, you know, diverted into those pits, water harvesting pits, so that it easily gets percolated into the through the different layers being already like being managed by people and passes down into the lower levels. And this has recharged the groundwater levels and even brought rivers back to life. So these were basically, you know, some kind of water harvesting techniques which people, local people, have been following. Yeah. Structures which are still used today, something like water harvesting techniques are highly local specific and benefits. Basically, they are, you know, localized structures, whatever are seen. That is permitted or been, you know, been to only smaller areas of one small village, right? So that they are, it provides moisture for vegetation over a wide area, and it is also preventing from, right, breeding of excessive mosquitoes, because stagnation of water doesn't occur. And then groundwater is also being protected from getting contaminated because of human and animal waste. So this is next. Have a look at coal and petroleum. So these are the important resources, that is the fossil fuels of coal and petroleum. Now they are responsible for providing of energy. Since industrial revolution, we've been using excessive energy to meet our basic needs for the manufacturing of the goods which are necessary for our daily necessities or to meet our demands and luxuries. And the energy needs have been largely met by the reservoirs or the reserves which have been of coal and petroleum. Okay, so here, when the coal and petroleum were formed, it is because of the degradation of the biomass some millions of years ago. But what has happened now? Excessive usage of these resources is getting it or making it exhausted, and it will no ways be available in the future generations. So now we have to be very much precise and careful on how to use them, and if we have to check for any alternative sources of energy, something like solar energy. And then it has been also been estimated that resources of petroleum may not last for more than 40 years, and coal may get exhausted by the next 200 years. So now, because these coal and petroleum are formed because of the biomass, they excessively contain carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, sulfur, etc. So when they are being burnt as fuels, they release out carbon dioxide, oxides of nitrogen and sulfur, some amount of vapor. And when the combustion takes place in an insufficient air where oxygen availability is not proper, carbon monoxide would be formed instead of carbon dioxide. And this carbon monoxide release basically, or the oxides of sulfur and nitrogen, they are all poisonous at a higher concentration. And we also know that this carbon dioxide is in greenhouse gas. So these prevented. So some of the simple choices which we can make and which will make a difference for our energy consumptions would be utilizing the different materials in our surroundings, or we can say environment friendly materials. That is usage of like LED bulbs or fluorescent tubes in our houses. Instead of utilizing lift, we can use the stairs. Wearing an extra sweater instead of usage of heating device or heaters. Or we can use certain methods like keeping ourselves warm by certain simple techniques, like, you know, where the thermal insulation has been more, wearing of jackets and all in the cold days. And then management of coal and petroleum also addresses the efficiency of machines. The fuel is very much commonly used in the engines for different types of transport methods, for the different fields. Okay, so that these can be utilized to carry on with different activities. Now, if the consumption is reduced, okay, its efficiency or the amount content of these resources in the nature will also be there. Maintaining some certain levels will be available for now and for upcoming generations, and it would also reduce pollution. Sustainable management of natural resources, though being a difficult task, when we are talking about this issue, we need to keep our like self with an open mindedness, wherein when we talk about the stakeholders, people utilizing the resources, we need to accept the willfulness of the people in supporting these actions against the excessive usage of resources. And then realization of the people because of their selfish goals is a must. That is, the selfish goals will lead to misery for a large number of people and also would cause destruction to the environment. And then if we are following the rules, laws and certain regulations amended by the government, we ourselves should amend few to ourselves so that we are saving our resources in the environment. So for that, we need to tailor or cut down certain requirements of ours. So finally, we can say that individually or collectively, the benefits of development could finally reach everyone right now as well for the upcoming generations, so that everyone lives peacefully. And by this, we can conclude this topic of sustainable management of natural resources. I hope the topic is understood. Thank you so much.